Thank you. blessed Sabbath morning to one and all, my beloved brothers and sisters in Christ. May the peace and joy of the Lord be with you all as we worship God together once again as a corporate body of Christ this morning. First, I'd like to welcome two friends of Pastor Amos. They are representative from the Habitat for Humanity. They'll be briefing this afternoon and they are here to help us. So I want to welcome Andrew and Rachel. Andrew and Rachel, let's stand up from where you are. Andrew and Rachel. Yes, they are there. And congregation, let's all rise to give each other a warm welcome in the name of the Lord as we worship Him together. Turn to your left, right, front, behind to greet each other in the name of the Lord. Indeed, it's always my joy and delight to see people of God coming together in fellowship and worship. Just for announcement, for your kind attention and action before we begin the service proper. So first of all, a short video clip from the Alpha course.
My name is Max, and I run a business providing security solutions. I enjoy interacting with different people from many types of industries. When I'm not at work, I like being outdoors, enjoying nature. Music has always been one of my passions. My journey to Alpha began when I was waiting for my customer outside his restaurant. It was raining quite heavily and the lady was standing under the shelter next to me. We started talking and she asked if I had heard about Alpha at the Book Cafe. I said no. She told me the tagline for Alpha was, "Is there more to life than this?" This caught my attention because I was facing some problems in my business, some staff had left the company, and I had recently ended a 4-year relationship. It was a really stressful and painful period in my life, and I was at a loss at how to handle everything. I needed to find some answers, so I decided to attend Alpha. My first Alpha experience was really good. People at the Book Cafe were really warm and friendly. The environment was cozy and the food was good too. I enjoyed the video. It made sense and the discussions after were so lively. I also enjoyed hearing so many different perspectives on what life is really about, and I look forward to attending the sessions each week. Before Alpha, I had no knowledge of Christianity or God. Through Alpha, I met Him. I see now that life is so different when we walk with God. This journey has taught me to look at life with a different perspective. Faith, hope, and love are the three things that I have gained, and building on this foundation has transformed not only my relationship with God, but also my relationships with my colleagues, clients, friends, and family. I now know God. I have received the good news and understand His goodness and His love. I now have a purpose in life. It is no longer just about me, but about serving Him and His people. Got questions about life? Try Alpha.
I believe there are many people like Max outside in your neighborhood, in your office, or on the street. Take the step of faith and courage to invite someone like Max to the Alpha course. Now, Alpha program is a two-stage or two-part event. First part is what we call the Alpha Intro Lunch, happening on the 26th of August. And we'd like you to use this platform to invite your loved ones and friends who have yet to know Christ. You don't know how to introduce Christ to them, but this is a platform for them to come and discover from themselves what Alpha can offer them. What are the questions that can be answered that they have, like exploring life, faith, meaning, is there more to life than this? All right. So I appeal to all of you. I'm sure around you have loved ones and friends who have yet to know Christ. Invite them to the intro lunch first on the 26th of August, the last Saturday August, from 12 to 3 at the NUS Guild House at Suntec City. All right? And we need you to send this invitation to them, scan and register for them. All right? It's only 2 weeks from now. So do your part as a disciple of Christ in reaching out to them. You know, they say that evangelism is the best form of discipleship. So do your part. And the second part of Alpha is after they have signed up for the Alpha course, the actual Alpha classes will begin on the 2nd of September over six Saturday morning from 9 to 1, here in church, 2nd September, all the way to 14 October. All right? So you feel that you have not done anything in reaching out to the lost, this is the opportunity, end the year 2023 meaningfully and purposefully. So once again, I appeal to you, invite your loved ones and friends to sign up for this, to come for this intro lunch, and then to sign up for the 6th Saturday Alpha class. Next announcement, this is an event organized by our men's fellowship. It's open to all church members. The event is called Practicing God's Presence in Everyday Life. You don't only feel the presence of God on Sunday morning. You can practice it every day of your life. And how to do that? We have invited a speaker. He's none other than the principal of BGST, Dr. Lai Pak Hua. He will address us on the Saturday afternoon from 12:30 to 1. Sorry, on the Sunday afternoon, 12:30 to 1:30. That is the last Sunday of August, 27 August. So mark this event on the calendar. Scan to register for this event. Here in church, only 1 hour after the service, 12:30 to 1:30. And next, Jim, let's look at their recent event at the, they call it the Changi Sunrise Walk, all right? A short video clip. They started with an empty stomach, they always end up with a full stomach. So there's always food when you join gym, all right? That was a recent event. And the upcoming event, also organized by Jim, is a talk by our own very own elder, Elder Jason, on the title, My End is Not the End. Question is like, what happens when we die as believers in Christ? How should we prepare ourselves to face God? What happens on the other side? So come and discover for yourself on 2nd September, Saturday, 9 a.m. to 10:30 a.m. at the Bochin Hall, all right? And last but not least, next Sunday is a special occasion for our church. What is happening in our church? It's our church birthday, our 27th anniversary. So take this opportunity again. Every opportunity you have, seize it to invite your loved ones to come and join us and be blessed. And there'll be a buffet lunch after the service at Level 1. All right, so that's all for the announcement and thank for attention. And now hand the time to Magdalene and her team to lead us in the time of worship.
Let us prepare our hearts to worship God. Let us pray. Our Father, maker of heaven and earth, we praise you for your almighty acts. We praise you for you are the all-knowing God. No sin can be hidden from you. Father, we know that time and time again, we often choose our own ways rather than submit to your guidance. However, time and time again, you are always faithful and never forsake us. Thank you for the blood of Jesus Christ that has redeemed us. Thank you for your providence. Thank you for the calling, privilege, and importance of worshiping together. May we come prepared and ever more grateful for your love and mercy. You alone are worthy to be praised. Father, we pray that you will feed our minds with your word, fill our hearts with your grace, empower our worship by your spirit. May we gather as true worshippers for your sake and not ours, longing to be consumed with your glory and grace. In Jesus' most precious name we pray. Amen. Please stand for the call to worship, taken from Psalm 108, verses 1 to 5. My heart is steadfast, O God. I will sing and make melody with all my being. Awake, O harp and lyre. I will awake the dawn. I will give thanks to you, O Lord, amongst the peoples. I will sing praises to you among the nations. For your steadfast love is great above the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches to the clouds. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth. Our God is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. Congregation, may we join our hearts in this time of praise and worship to give all glory and honor to our God. Great is thy faithfulness. Is faithful, all that we needed, he has provided. We thank God for his never-ending blessings. Let us continue to give him praise and lift up his name, for he is our Redeemer and Savior of our souls. Together.
Jehovah God of Israel, the deliverer of our own, we come to you and you alone
to worship you, God.
And all our God eternal, the Redeemer.
seated. As we sing this next song, let us remember that it was the blood of Jesus Christ that has ransomed us from the bondage of sin. This song is a bit long and it is new, but I hope the congregation will learn this song together with me and the worship team. And we hope that this song will minister, the words that will minister to you, and you can sing it every day of your life. We will lead the song. Congregation, please join in after verse 1.
I was a wretch, I remember who I was. I was lost, I was blind, I was running out of time. Sin separated, the breach was far too wide. But from the far side of the chasm, you had me in your sight.
Together.
I was a wretch, I remember who I was.
I was lost.
I was lost.
I was blind.
I was blind. I was running out of time. Sin separated, the breach was far too wide. But from the far side of the chasm, you had me in your sight. So you made a way across the great divide. Left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. And there at the cross, you paid the debt I owed. Broke my chains, freed my soul. For the first time I had hope. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, you has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life. Brought me from the darkness into glorious light.
Let's sing it again.
Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, you have washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life. Brought me from the darkness into glorious light. You took my place, lay inside my tomb of sin. You were buried for 3 days, but then you walked right out again. And now death has no sting, and life has no end. For I have been transformed by the blood of the Lamb. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, it has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have Thank you, Jesus, for the blood, the blood.
Let us praise Him.
Thank you, Jesus, you have washed me white.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life, brought me from the darkness into glory.
Let us rise. Thank you, Jesus. Give glory to His name.
Glory to His name.
Glory to His name.
Glory to His name. Dead to my heart was the blood applied. Glory.
To His name.
Glory to His name. Glory to His name.
Amen. Please be seated.
Indeed, there's nothing stronger than the power of the blood of Christ that's enabled us to come into the throne room of God to make our petition known to Him. Let's unite our hearts now to make our petition known to God. Almighty God, Eternal Father, as we draw near before Your throne of grace and mercy once again this morning, we humbly commit unto You several concerns that weigh heavily on our hearts. First, we pray for Your mercy upon the inhabitants of this planet world, planet Earth, which is groaning for redemption. Our selfishness and our disobedience to Your command to be good stewards of all the natural resources and beauty creation You have blessed us with, have led to an increasing occurrences of extreme weather around the world recently, with rising temperature in many parts of Europe and the Middle East, raging fires in Hawaii, Cyprus, Italy, and Portugal, heavy rains and deadly floods in Slovenia, South Korea, Japan, China, and Myanmar, as well as devastating earthquake striking Alaska in July, eastern part of China on August 6, central New Zealand and northern Japan just 2 days ago. Yes, indeed, as the United Nations Human Rights Chief has recently observed, the extreme summer heat in southern Iraq of 50 degrees Celsius has made it clear that the era of global boiling has begun. Have great, great mercy on us, dear God. Before things get worse, please grant each of us a heart of humility, an attitude of consideration, in our habits of consumption, in our utilization of precious but limited resources each day of our lives. And dearest God, with a world in increasing turmoil, with many still groping in darkness aimlessly, unprepared to face You on the day of judgment, we dare not neglect the unsaved souls of all our loved ones and friends. We pray that the veil, the blindness which Satan has put over their minds to prevent them from seeing the glorious light of the gospel, be removed, be taken away by your mercy, so that they may come to experience and embrace your Son, Jesus Christ, as their personal Lord and Savior, sooner than later. And in this regard, O Lord, we commit our forthcoming Alpha Intro Lunch on 26 August and the subsequent Alpha classes commencing on 2nd September unto your sovereign and powerful hand. May our loved ones and friends who have yet to know Christ accept our invitation to come for the Alpha Intro Lunch to get an idea of what the Alpha course is all about and why they should attend and register for it. And more so, may we be burdened and emboldened enough to extend our invitation to them urgently and sincerely. O Lord, we pray for a great harvest of souls to this round of Alpha course. Next, I commit to you, dearest God, the spiritual condition and well-being of my beloved flock here in AGPC, both young and old. I may not know exactly what each of them is struggling or confronted with in their lives right now, but dearest God, you know them. You know them personally, fully and deeply. May you have great mercy on them and be gracious unto them and grant them the wisdom, joy and strength equal to the trials and afflictions they are going through right now, so that they may emerge as victors and conquerors at the end of their faith-stretching journey. For the lovely and lively children you have blessed our church with, we commit each and every one of them unto your loving and mighty hand at this moment. We pray, dearest God, that you would be their sun and shield, and that you will continue to shower your abundant blessing of wisdom, strength, and joy upon them at each stage of their growth and development. Please help our dear children to know you personally and learn the importance of placing their complete trust in you. For you are the sovereign God, and everyone who trusts in you will never, never be disappointed. Yes, Lord, teach them. Teach them also to be faithful in all their responsibilities and to honor all their commitments, even at a young age. Fill each of our children with your abiding presence and guide them with your tender mercy, that they may have a strong awareness of your presence each day of their lives, and may their growth and development be progressive and wholesome, physically, emotionally, intellectually, socially, and above all, spiritually. And for the youth among us, we ask that you continue to bless each of them with the counsel and guidance of the Holy Spirit, so that after their years of education, they will turn out to be a true disciple of Jesus Christ, with a godly character and a humble disposition, a disciple who loves you, who puts you first in their life always. And may your Holy Spirit rebuke and convict them whenever they go astray. Keep them away from every bad and evil influence of the world. Teach them to be God-fearing, people-caring, and sin-hating, and to do only the things that are right and pleasing unto you always. Last but not least, O Lord, we commit our upcoming project homeworks in partnership with Habitat for Humanity unto your loving hand. We thank you for the 50 participants from our congregation who have signed up for this worthy cause. We pray that every household to be visited by the assigned participants will see and experience the love of Christ incarnated in our simple deeds of cleaning and refurbishing their house. May all the beneficiaries be deeply touched and personally ministered to through this project homeworks, and more so, may the name of our Lord Jesus Christ be lifted high and far. Hear this, O Lord, our sincere and earnest prayer, for we ask this in the strong and saving name of your Son, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Let us prepare ourselves for the proclamation of God's word. May God grant us an undivided heart and remove everything that is in our way to listen to his word.
together.
For the responsive reading. Taken from 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 6 to 12. Verse 6. But godliness with contentment is great gain, for we brought nothing into the world, and we cannot take anything out of the world.
But if we have food and clothing, with these we will be content. But those who desire to be rich fall into temptation, into a snare, into many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction.
For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. It is through this craving that some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many pangs. But as for you, O man of God, flee these things, pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, steadfastness, gentleness. Together,
fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called, and about which you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses.
Please remain standing for the scripture reading.
Today's scripture passage is taken from Judges chapter 2. Now the angel of the Lord went up from Gilgal to Bochim, and he said, I brought you up from Egypt and brought you into the land that I swore to give to your fathers. I said, I will never break my covenant with you, and you shall make no covenant with the inhabitants of this land. You shall break down their altars, but you have not obeyed my voice. What is this you have done? So now I say, I will not drive them out before you. But they shall become thorns in your sides, and their gods shall be a snare to you. As soon as the angel of the Lord spoke these words to all the people of Israel, the people lifted up their voices and wept, and they called the name of that place Bochim, and they sacrificed there to the Lord. When Joshua dismissed the people of Israel went each to his inheritance to take possession of the land. And the people served the Lord all the days of Joshua and all the days of the elders who outlived Joshua, who had seen all the great work that the Lord had done for Israel. And Joshua, the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died at the age of 110 years. And they buried him within the boundaries of his inheritance in Timnath-Heres, in the hill country of Ephraim, north of the mountain of Geash. And all that generation also were gathered to their fathers. And there arose another generation after them who did not know the Lord or the work that he had done for Israel. And the people of Israel did what was evil in the sight of the Lord and served the Baals, and they abandoned the Lord, the God of their fathers, who had brought them out of the land of Egypt. They went after other gods from among the land, from among the gods of the peoples who were around them, and bowed down to them. And they provoked the Lord to anger. They abandoned the Lord and served the Baals and the Ashtaroth. So the anger of the Lord was kindled against Israel, and he gave them over to plunderers who plundered them. And he sold them into the hand of their surrounding enemies, so that they could no longer withstand their enemies. Whenever they marched out, the hand of the Lord was against them for harm, as the Lord had warned, and as the Lord had sworn to them, and they were in terrible distress. Then the Lord raised up judges who saved them out of the hand of those who plundered them. Yet they did not listen to their judges, for they hauled after other gods and bowed down to them. They soon turned aside from the way in which their fathers had walked, who had obeyed the commandments of the Lord, and they did not do so. Whenever the Lord raised up judges for them, the Lord was with the judge, and he saved them from the hand of their enemies all the days of the judge. For the Lord was moved to pity by their groaning because of those who afflicted and oppressed them. But whenever the judge died, they turned back and were more corrupt than their fathers, going after other gods, serving them and bowing down to them. They did not drop any of their practices or their stubborn ways. So the anger of the Lord was kindled against Israel, and he said, because this people has transgressed my covenant that I commanded their fathers and have not obeyed my voice, I will no longer drive out before them any of the nations that Joshua left when he died, in order to test Israel by them, whether they will take care to walk in the way of the Lord as their fathers did or not. So the Lord left those nations, not driving them out quickly, and he did not give them into the hand of Joshua. This is the word of God. Please be seated.
Good morning, everyone. Before we begin, let's go to God in prayer, shall we? Father, we have come to this place of worship this morning. We've opened our hearts to you as we have heard your word read to us, in your Spirit impressing them upon our minds and our hearts. You speak in and through all these things, and we ask that you will minister deeply to us in the preaching of your word now as we gather together in this sanctuary and in our homes. You know our needs, and we desire to know your grace. So draw us near by your Holy Spirit and do the work that only you can do. For your own praise and glory, all these things we ask together in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. I have two readings for us this morning. We stood up for the first because it's God's word from the Bible. But we will remain seated for the second reading, which is from the Wall Street Journal. And this article is from its 21st April 2000 issue, entitled Redefining God, written by Alyssa Miller. Now in it, she cites a Professor Randall Stiers from Union Theological Seminary, New York. And he says, across the country, the faithful are redefining God. Dissatisfied with conventional images of an authoritarian or paternalistic deity, people are embracing quirky, individualistic conceptions of God to suit their own spiritual needs. They are cobbling together a spiritual life from a variety of religious influences, along with a dash of yoga and psychotherapy, or whatever else moves them. People seek out these new gods the way people seek out new products in the marketplace. It's the ultimate form of individualism. Oh, something wrong with my tongue this morning. Lisa then cites Ken Zwingard, a 43-year-old lawyer from Oskaloosa, Kansas. Growing up in a strict Lutheran household, he used to imagine God as a Santa Claus type, a provider and a judge. But as he matured, Mr. Zwingard became frustrated with the church and started waking every Sunday mornings to go fishing instead. Today for him, God is being alone on the lake, seeing the fog lift at sunrise and hearing the water bells. When he teaches his children, then 2 and 3 years old, about who God is, he says, I plan to take them outside and say, here it is. Now, alongside this article in the journal, there's a side panel citing the responses of 10 people from various backgrounds to the question, what is God, rather than who is God? To give you the gist, I would like to share four of these responses. First, Reverend James Forbes, a senior minister at Riverside Church, New York, and said that God is a force field of positive energy. Danny Goldberg, then CEO of Artemis Records, who describes himself as a Jewish, said God is pure love, intense feelings of love. Bill Joy, co-founder of Sun Microsystem and a self-described Protestant, added, as scientists, we can say God is part of our genes. And finally, Dana Bookman, who is a fashion designer and identifies herself as a Presbyterian, said, I don't believe in God, but I think often a close relative who had an effect on my life and values, it's like ancestor worship. Now, I intentionally read this article, though the examples are very American, but I believe it's relatable to us here in Singapore as well. And I can easily cite the Singapore equivalent as well, where we have replaced the sacred duty of coming together to worship God once a week to that important tuition, work project or assignment, or family gathering, or some seminars we've got to attend. You see, the views just shared do bring the whole book of Judges out of its historical context and right into our time in the 21st century. What we have just read from the Wall Street Journal describes exactly what's happening in the book of Judges. So this morning we look at Judges chapter 2, for it is of great importance that we see and understand what is it that God wants to say to a generation like us. So we take up the story in chapter 2, verse 6, where we are told that after Joshua had dismissed the Israelites, they then went to take possessions of the land, each of his own inheritance. You would have recalled in Joshua chapter 24, Joshua had organized a huge national event in which the people had renewed their covenant commitment with God. They had said they would put away their idols. They are then told that they went back to their homes and, according to verse 7, Judges chapter 2, served the Lord throughout the lifetime of Joshua and the elders who had outlived him, and those who had seen the great things that the Lord had done for Israel. So here now is a whole generation who had directly, personally experienced the saving action of God. The oldest folks in this generation would probably have been very young when the Exodus took place from Egypt. They could have just remembered it from their childhood. They would have been raised in the desert, and after those 40 years in the wilderness, and by the time they had got into the land of Canaan, they would have been in their late 40s or 50s, and was about to enjoy retirement in the land. Then the younger generation came up, and you would have been born in the desert during this 40-year period. They would have been in their 20s or 30s, under the leadership of Joshua and under the heat of the battle, the campaign to take the land. And that probably took about 15 years or so. And so they would have spent the middle years of their life and their retirement in the land of Canaan as well. But eventually, the time came when they too also died. Now look at verse 10. And all that generation also were gathered to their fathers. And there arose another generation after them who did not know the Lord or the work that he had done for Israel. Now, this is one of the saddest verses in the whole of the Bible, but it sets the scene of the whole book of Judges. And this book is going to tell us what happens when a new generation grows up without knowing God, not knowing what he has done for his people. And you will find, as you read through this book, that it is not a very pleasant reading. So the book of Judges begins a very new chapter for God and his people. And this is a chapter that is of greatest importance for us today. You see, in the desert, even though the people of God often disobeyed and sometimes disbelieved him, they nonetheless knew who God is and what he has done for Israel. That generation that crossed over the Red Sea without getting their feet wet, that generation had gathered manna, miraculous food that came from heaven every morning. That generation had stood at the bottom of Mount Sinai when God had come down onto the mountain with great smoke and fire, with the magnificent sound of trumpets. And just imagine, God's majestic presence had shaken the surrounding mountains like a great earthquake, so that the people were terrified and said to Moses, "Please, you yourself go up onto the mountain and speak to God in his presence, for we do not want to speak to him, or we will die." So these people knew who God was, and they know who God is and what he has done for Israel. So if the Wall Street Journal were to send a reporter around that time and ask the people, "What is God?" they would immediately retort, "Wrong question. You should ask, who is God?" And they would reply, "He is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He is the God who had appeared to Moses and said, 'I am who I am.' He is the God who had come down to Mount Sinai and gave the Ten Commandments. He is the Creator, the Savior, and the Judge. He has delivered his people from slavery. He is holy and righteous, loving and merciful, gracious and good. And he is to be worshipped, and he is to be feared. He is to be loved, and he is to be adored. And he is the living God." Now, these people don't always obey the Lord, but at least they knew who God is and what God has done. But now we are being told that there arose another new generation who do not have this knowledge. They do not know who God is and what God has done. And so their problem is not unbelief. Their problem is that they do not even have the knowledge that they could believe. How can they believe, says the Apostle Paul, in one whom they do not even have the knowledge that they could believe? And so this raised a very important question for us. How could this happen in just one generation? Now, what do you think? And my guess, the answer is that the parents were too busy building a life in a prosperous land flowing with milk and honey. This generation who had seen God doing wonderful things in their own life clearly neglected the teaching to their children. There's so much to do, so much enrichment, entertainment, reading the scriptures. Okay, we'll try, okay? And as a result, within one generation, the knowledge of God was lost, even within a culture as religious as Israel. Now, doesn't this strike a similar note here in Singapore, where we all strive for the good life, the things that the world can offer? We want good grades, good cars, good houses, good salaries, good holidays. So much so that we are so exhausted by the time it comes to Sunday. And it's such a struggle to get up for service, isn't it? To attend that DG or that fellowship event. So please note that as we come to this very important theme in the Bible, that it is an absolute priority for parents, for teachers, for discipleship group leaders, for spiritual mentors, and for every Christian who is walking among others of the other faith, who are concerned about the spiritual life of AGPC and our own nation. The passage tells us the importance of teaching the next generation who God is, and we are to teach the next generation what God has done. Well, the good things in life that has to offer in Singapore are important, but more important than these are the essentials of our Christian faith, which defines who we are, and we should be absolutely clear about its core curriculum. It's not just about raising up a Jonathan or an Abigail to be a good boy or girl. Jonathan must know who God is. Abigail must know what God has done. For only then, and with that knowledge, would they be in a position to make a meaningful response of faith and obedience to the living God. Now remember, parents and mentors, it is not just your job to bring up a Jonathan or an Abigail to the faith. This is something only the Holy Spirit can do. But God has given a task, this task, to every parent, to everyone here, to teach every Jonathan and Abigail what the faith is. And we must remember that as Jonathan and Abigail grows up in our culture, they are going to be surrounded by peers and friends that believe that God is a force field of positive energy, or that supposedly Zen-like feeling when they look at nature and all its beauty, or even that Santa Claus in the sky that is relevant only when we need something, when we are in trouble. Now that's the challenge we are facing. And our great need today is in our homes, where parents are to live out in response to knowing who God is and what God has done in their lives, so that their children too, in turn, will get to know who God is and what God has done. Secondly, in our churches, where pastors will teach their congregation who God is and what God has done. In seminaries, where professors will teach students who God is and what God has done. And so we see that it only took one generation of neglect for the knowledge of God to be lost, even in a religious culture. But what can be lost in one culture, one generation, can by the grace of God be restored in one generation too. And that is our challenge. And here is a test by which we should measure the value of each ministry in AGPC. We should ask ourselves that as a result of this ministry, do the people know who God is? Do the people know what God has done? Now that's the challenge. And so the book of Judges goes on to explain a cycle of events that occurred many times over a period of several hundred years. There are basically three stages in this cycle that I'm sure many of us are familiar with. First, idolatry, where we find the people of God forsaking God and turning to idols. And as a result, we find God becomes angry and hands them over to the power of their enemies in judgment. That's stage two. And stage three, we find that under distress, the people cry out to God, and God responds in grace by sending them a deliverer or a judge who saves them from their oppressors, resulting in the land enjoying a time of peace. But when the time of peace had been completed, we find the cycle starts all over again. They forsake the Lord and turn to their idols. Then God hands them over to the power of their enemies. Then they begin to cry out in distress, and God raises a judge to deliver them. And this cycle goes on and on again, repeatedly throughout the book of Judges. Idolatry, judgment, grace. Idolatry, judgment, grace. Now let's take a look at each of these three components of the cycle. And I would like us to study two of these cycles. One in chapter 2, where that's a general summary. And then you'll have a succinct summary of the cycle in chapter 3, starting at verse 7, under the judge Othniel. Now let's take a look at stage 1 in the cycle, which is idolatry. Judges chapter 2, verse 12, "And they abandoned the Lord, the God of their fathers, who had brought them out of the land of Egypt, and they went after other gods, from among the gods of the people who were around them, and they bowed down to them." Now, if we look at the parallel account in Judges chapter 3, verse 7, you will see the same thing. And the people of Israel did what was evil in the sight of the Lord, and they forgot the Lord their God, and served the Baals and the Asheroth. And as we read through the Old Testament from this point onwards, we keep coming across this business of idolatry. Every few pages, we come across references to idols, either the Baals, or the Asherahs, or the Molech, or the Dagon. And when we read this, they all seem very distant from us. But they come up so often, even today. So it is of significance to what God is trying to warn us. The Wall Street Journal tells us now what idolatry is in modern times. Listen to what it says again. "Across the country, the faithful are redefining God. They are embracing quirky, individualistic conceptions of God to suit their own spiritual needs. So according to the journal, US is full of it. But this is also true in Singapore. Just look at how we view the importance of our relationship with God or our spiritual health versus things like academic studies, our career, or the need to advance in life, our love life, relationship, etc. Of course, we don't hear much about the Baals or the Molech or the Dagon today. We have replaced them with a force field of positive energy, or pure intense feeling of love, or seeing the fog lift up at sunrise and hearing the water bell. Redefining God. This is the essence of idolatry, whether ancient or modern. So if we don't get that promotion or the academic grades we want, why, God, why? Or we get ill, or our relationship doesn't work out. Why, God? So God becomes the proverbial genie or the butler in the sky that is supposed to keep us happy all the time. Else we will get angry. Now I wonder, wherever do we get such a conception of God? When, since when? Does this reading from the Bible, does it tell us that God is like that? The holy, holy, holy God, almighty and sovereign, all-knowing and wise. Now, isn't it striking and remarkable that 3,400 years after the period of Judges, we are still in this position where a leading newspaper would describe idolatry in such striking similarity? Now, that should immediately make us realize that idolatry is a powerful, attractive phenomenon that will always be with us in some measure. And the reason that idolatry is so powerful, attractive, is that it puts you in the absolute control. So instead of having the living God who says, "I am who I am," men and women in every generation have preferred to create a God who suits their own spiritual needs. That's what the Wall Street Journal reports. So we want a God-like figure to serve our needs, rather than a God who has revealed who He is in the Bible. That means we will reject the living God as He has revealed Himself, and then we bow down to this God-like idol. So God responds by saying, "Okay, I hear you clearly. Then I will withdraw, and I'll take my hand away of protection that has been upon you for all these years, and I will deliver you into the hands of your enemies." And this is the story of the book of Judges. So the first part of the cycle is idolatry. Now look at the second part with me, judgment. In verse 12, we see that they provoked the Lord to anger because they forsook Him and served the Baals. Therefore, in God's anger, verse 14 tells us that He handed them over to the raiders who plundered them. Now, if you look at the parallel account in Judges chapter 3, verse 8, it says that the anger of the Lord burned against Israel, that He sold them into the hands of Cushan, the king of Aram. So we see that the people has rejected the Lord, and He creates a crisis in order to bring His people back. Friends, God loves you. He loves His people. He is a covenant. He has a covenant with His people. One generation ago, their parents just renewed that covenant. And when they are unfaithful to Him, His anger is provoked, just like a jilted lover or a spurned spouse. And so God created a crisis in order to bring the people back to Him. He withdraws His protection and allows them to live with the consequences of their own decision, their own choice. "If you don't want my help, then I will let you live without my help." And God says, now it's important for us to understand that this is the way that God often deals with our persistent sin, and in particular, the sin of idolatry. Now I want you to turn to one other cross-reference this morning, as I think it is helpful for understanding a great deal of the Old Testament. It's found in Genesis chapter 15, verse 16. Tells us that while God had promised Abraham the land of Canaan then, it would not happen until another 400 years. Verse 16 says, it will happen in the fourth generation, which means after the length of four lifetimes put together in the land of Egypt. Now, why take 400 years before God gives the land to the descendants of Abraham? What do you think? For the sins of the Amorites had not yet reached its full measure. Now, that's a very important statement to remember. You see, the Amorites is the general term to collectively describe all the various tribal groups inhabiting the land of Canaan before the invasion of the Israelites. And here we are told that the Amorites were sinning against God, and yet God is patient and slow to anger. He overlooked their sins for 400 years of idolatry and evil. Now that's pretty patient, is it not? But do hear me clearly. There will come a point, which is described here by God, that the sins of the Amorites will reach its full measure. And when that point comes, as determined by God, God acts in judgment. And in this case, He acts to remove them and He ejects them from the land. And at the same time, during the 400 years, God is not only patiently overlooking their sins, but He is also working in the lives of His people, Israel. He allowed them to go through the prolonged period of suffering. He disciplines them through the experience of slavery in Egypt and now brings them out and wonderfully redeems them. But He finds that they are not ready to fully trust Him and follow Him faithfully. So God leads them for another 40 years in the wilderness, until they are ready to take another initiative of faith. And at this point, Israel is now ready to enter into God's blessing. The time of blessing has come for Israel, but the time of judgment has come for the Amorites. And in His sovereign power, God brings those two things together in perfect timing, so that one fits the other. Now here we are, a generation later, and we find that Israel had turned away from the Lord and has turned to the very idols that the Amorites were worshipping. And they are adopting the very evil for which God has judged the Amorites. So what does God do? He gives His people over into the hands of the Amorites. And we learn that idolatry always, in God's time, leads to judgment. So idolatry leads to judgment. And under the judgment of God, oppressed by their enemies, what then happens? The people of God turns back to Him and cries out to Him for His help, and He saves. Now I wonder if Lissa Miller of the Wall Street Journal did read the book of Judges. For this is what she writes when describing the move towards the new gods, which she sees come under the same term as idolatry of the old. She writes, "Even as people search for deeper connections with God, they aren't facing the kind of crisis that often prompts people to seek protection and salvation from above." And she ends her article by saying, "Tough times or sudden hardship could change all this in a hurry. For no matter how broad or far-flung people's conception of God, they revert to God the Father when the going gets tough." Now that's very insightful. That's exactly what the book of Judges tells us, that while people engage in idol gods of their own making for many, many years, when God delivers them into the hands of their enemies, they turn back to the living God. For when the going gets tough, the question is very simple. Is there a God who can act? Is there a God who can do something to help you in the crisis that you are facing? And how in the world, when you face a crisis in your life, would calling upon the morning mist that rises from the lake is going to help you? What good is a force field of positive energy do for you when you are lying on your deathbed? But the Bible tells us that whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And listen, this is what we are to teach the next generation who do not know God. Know Him as having a personal relationship and experience Him daily in our lives. We are to say that there is a living God. He says, I am who I am. And we cannot redefine him. And any effort to do so is simply idolatry. And he judges idolatry. And so we should not go down that pathway. Yet, he is gracious to all who call upon him and will turn to him in faith. This God is in heaven, so turn to him and he will deliver you. And this is the story of the book of Judges. And as his people cry out to him in faith, God sends saviors or deliverers to deliver the people. And you can read through the whole book. Samgar, Ehud, Deborah, Gideon, Japheth, Samson, and others. The Bible tells us that the Spirit of the Lord came on these people and enabled them to do remarkable things, that they delivered the people of God from their enemies. So through the ministry of these judges, the blessing of God is restored to the people. But as you read through the book, it is clear that these deliverers had severe limitations. It's very hard to admire them. Most of them are lacking seriously in character as well. You'll find this as you read through the book. Ehud, the left-handed one holding the dagger, he kind of reminds me like an assassin. You should really read his story. How about Gideon? He's so lacking in faith that he seems to need multiple confirmations from God before he would even do a simple task that God has called him to do. He made a disastrous choice that involved the sacrifice of his own daughter. And Samson's failures are legendary, which qualifies him the title as the weakest strong man who had ever lived. So not only were major defects in their characters, you know, we see the judges. These judges were never quite able to change the heart of the people. And that's why the story keeps going round and round in cycle. Idolatry, judgment, and then grace through the raising of a judge. And then more idolatry again. You see, even though the external circumstances of Israel were changed by the relieving of the oppression, the internal corruption of the heart were never touched by these judges. And so the book of Judges leaves us all asking the same question. How long will these cycles go on? When will there be a deliverer who can touch the issues of the heart? In addition, there's this serious limitation that all these judges die, which may seem to be an obvious thing to point out, but nonetheless, the book of Judges points it out repeatedly. God raises a judge, and all goes well during the lifetime of the judge, and then the judge dies. And we go through another cycle again. And as you read through this book, by the end of it, I'm sure that you will come to the same conclusion as I did. We definitely need a better deliverer than these folks. We need a deliverer who can change the heart of God's people, not just the external circumstances. And we need a deliverer who can sustain changes that will last. So hit the fast forward button for to some 1,400 years ahead. And you'll find that the people of God are in the hands of another oppressor. And this time, they are the Romans. They have to pay taxes to Caesar, and they hate it. Justice is in the hands of the foreign autocrat called Pontius Pilate, which nobody liked him either. During this time, there were riots and attempts to overthrow the yoke of Caesar. And the people were hoping that God would raise a deliverer. There were men like Judas Iscariot who loved for God to raise up another deliverer like Ehud. Left hand or right hand, it doesn't matter as long as he holds a dagger, okay? And perhaps he could take out Pontius Pilate and others like him. Yet others like Simeon and Anna saw a deeper need, and they were praying for a deliverer who could touch the issues of the heart. And they all cried out, and God did a new thing. He sent his son into the world. Now, Jesus is the image of the invisible God, the exact representation of his being. He is who God is, and he does what God does. He says what God says. What I do, he says, I see the Father doing. What I say is what the Father gives me to say. And his ministry is focused on the heart. And before his birth, the angel said to Joseph, you shall call him Jesus, because he shall save or deliver his people from their sins. Not from the external circumstances of the Roman occupation, but from the issues of the heart, their sins before God. And that is why when the crowd wanted to seize him, to make him some kind of a political king, an idolatry of God, he simply refused and walked away. For God can easily change the external circumstances of your life that bothers you so much. But if God does not change your heart, your life will be like the book of Judges, going round in endless cycles of changing circumstances, but never getting into the heart of the matter. And at the height of his ministry, the Lord Jesus was arrested and taken to the cross and crucified. The one whom God sends dies. And those who followed him and put their hopes in him must have felt like what the people felt when all the judges died. That's the end of the season. We are going into yet another cycle. But on the third day, Jesus rose from the dead. So this is the deliverer who will never die. And that means he's not only able to give you help at one point of your life, but lives as your deliverer for days, for weeks, for months, and for years until all eternity. And he will never fail. He will always live to be a deliverer for his people. So how must we respond to him? My friends, we must turn from our idols and turn to the living God. Now listen to me, friends. A God who only exists in your mind cannot deliver you. The living God thus invites each one of you to turn from your idols and call on him. And he promises that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Let us pray. Almighty God, we confess the presence of idols in our hearts and the idols in our nation. We see its offense and we bow before you. We want to come to you as you are, receiving you for all that you say and worshiping you for all that you do. We thank you that when your people cry out to you, you sent a deliverer. We thank you that you have sent Jesus Christ into the world. We thank you that he's not some kind of flawed judge, but the exact representation of your being. We thank you that he deals with deeper issues than just external circumstances. He is able to change our hearts. We thank you that he is not just with us for a while, but he has risen and death has no power over him. We thank you that he is forever the deliverer, the savior of his people. We bless you that you are the living God, the great I am. So gladly we turn from idols to serve you. We ask for your help as we go into a confused generation that do not know God and what he has done for his people. Help us to communicate who you are, that others may know and learn, and come by your Spirit to believe. O God, do it in our generation. May the knowledge of the living God, which has been lost, be graciously restored in the family, in the church, in our country, and throughout the world, by the power of your Spirit, for Jesus' sake. Amen.
Thank you, Preacher Joe, for delivering God's word. Let us further worship God with all our tithes and offerings. Directions for online transfers are given on the screen and also on our website. For those seated in the sanctuary, you may bring your tithes and offering to the box in front. Please remember, this bringing of our tithes and offerings is a Christian act of worship and obedience in accordance with His Word. Let us do so willingly and cheerfully unto the Lord as we reflect on His Word this morning. God sent His Son to deliver us from sin and death. How should we repay His great, great mercy? May we turn away from the idols of our life and remember the living God's love and grace. Please rise. His mercy is more.
What love can remember no wrongs we have done on this and on earth. Counts not their son thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more.
Verse 2.
What patience would we as we constantly roam?
Mercy is more.
Let's receive God's blessing together. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord turn His face towards you and give you peace. And now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen. Please be seated for a few moments of silent prayer, after which let's go forth and serve the Lord by remembering who God is and obeying all His commands.